Okay.
Yes.
I hope the screen is clear.
Yes, it is clear.
Thank you very much. First of all, I'd like to thank the organizing committee for giving us the chance to participate in this workshop and also to meet some people that we have never met before, just starting their work. And now we're here, we see them. And also some people we have met before, but now for a long time we haven't seen them. Just presenting here inverse source problems for degenerate time fractional BD. It's a joint work with the Karimov. The outline will be just a brief, very brief introduction, and then we'll talk about the first problem, which is about inverse source problem in space-degenerate BDE. And then we go to the second one, which is about the time-degenerate BDE. Yes, as you've seen from the outline, we present two inverse source problems, one for time-degenerate and the other one for space. It's in rectangular domains. Actually, the motivation for this, we were starting with some application in groundwater modeling, and then we see these kind of mathematical equations with some practical use. And also we have seen... We have seen further applications. For the example, the time fractional in space degenerate BDE can be related to some heat source and identification problems, while the inverse source problem for time degenerate BDE, it's related somehow to modeling of groundwater pollution. And recently, Dr. Erkin have found also another application very interesting regarding the diffusion of oxygen in soil, which is also related to this kind of problems. But anyway, in here we are going to tackle this problem just from mathematical point of view and to see how the mathematics looks like when it comes later on to real life problems. Of course, we need to take care of everything, all terms and conditions when it comes to real life problem. The first problem is formulated as follows. You see in the screen here, we are aiming to find a pair of solutions that satisfy this fractional differential equation with a space degenerate term in this rectangular domain together with some initial conditions given by this V of X and over determining condition given at the end time capital T W X. Of course, the assumption that this solution U and its derivative with respect to X are bounded at the end points. Our alpha is the between 0 and 1, and these two functions are given as we said. The method of solution is a classical one. We start with solving the homogeneous equation to get eigenfunctions. We are looking for serious solution, expansions in terms of eigenfunctions. To find this eigenfunction, we solve the corresponding homogeneous equation using separation of variables, and we produce the equation to this well-known Legendre equation, which is well-known that it has solution of Legendre polynomials with eigenvalues n times n plus 1. So all solutions that we are looking for will be expanded in a series solution, Fourier-Legendre series, and it will be a problem now to find this coefficient un and hn here. This initial data also and the terminal data also being expanded in this series, but this is all known. Vn and wn will be given by the well-known form for the coefficients of the Fourier-Legendre series. So we plug in these expressions into the original equations to try to find un and hn. And we got a very nice linear fractional differential equation, well known, together with some conditions. This is from the initial one, and this is from the overdetermining condition. The solution for this, again, it's well known. This is the first linear differential equation we have practiced. And the solutions were found to be, for n equal to zero, it has this form, and for n greater than zero, it will have the Mittag-Leffler function, as well known. So now it's left only to find the coefficient C naught, Cn, and H naught, and Hn. And this can be found by applying the conditions. Straightforward calculation, it just reduces to set of algebraic equations, solve these equations together. One can identify the coefficients. And then the final solution of the coefficients are given in this form. This is at n equal to zero, these two for u naught and h naught. And this is for un, and this is hn, again with this expression including Mittag-Leffler function. Plugging back to the solution of u and h, we got this serious solution. And as we all know, to have a complete solution, uniform convergence of these series has to be addressed. And it's not only this the series of u and h, but also the corresponding series of u double xx and also the Caput derivative of u. But the approach is almost the same. I'll discuss the convergence of these two series, and the others will be on the same manner. And of course, for the convergence, we will need estimates of the Mittag-Leffler function and also this Legendre polynomial, which is there given in literature with no problem at all. So using these estimates, one can arrive to this estimate for u and this estimate for h. And then the problem now reduced to finding the estimates of these coefficients of the given data, Wn and Vn. You can see them, they are appearing in this series here and also in the series of Hx. Of course, they are appearing here multiplied by n to the n plus one term, so more restriction will be required here than the series here. Again, the usual technique that we use to find this estimate for this is its integration by parts, but we will need some properties of the Legendre polynomials. Something like this, what's given here, will be used to find the estimate for Vn and Wn using integration by part. So we integrate by part first time for Vn, we'll get V prime and this term here using the properties can be reduced to this. And then we see the estimate. And also there is a nice properties for these Vn and Vn minus one. One can reduce that using these properties, one have from this estimate given by here. And of course we have used, you can see from here, we have used the Schwarz inequality, and also the norm of Vn is known to be this, have been used here to get this estimate. Applying this, repeating this one more time, and we will arrive to this estimate for Vn. And you can see the condition on the second derivative of V. Same thing can be done for the other term, W. And we'll see that the conditions need to ensure the uniform convergence is just this V and W to be in C, and the second derivative to be in L2. And solution will be convergent using the Weierstrass and test. For Hx, the source term, the series representation of the source term, as I said, because of the appearance of this term n times n plus one, that would require further integration by parts, and it's two more times, and then we will arrive, instead of having conditioning on V double prime, now we will reach the fourth derivative of this V and W. So we need now the condition that the fourth derivative to be in L2, to provide uniform convergence. And this is the summary of the main result of this. So this first problem of space-degenerate BDE is given in this form here, where the Vn and W are the coefficient of the Legendre Fourier series of the given data. For illustration, of course, also we have done this uniqueness of solution, which is, I'm not showing here, it's straightforward. The uniqueness of solution is done by the usual method, assuming that we have two solutions, and then we take the difference, and using the completeness properties of the system of Legendre polynomials will reach easily to the uniqueness of solution. So this main result, again, we illustrated with a very simple, straightforward example solution for sake of illustration. You should see that the method is working fine. And we have chosen here, again, we're taking things very easy for illustration. One of the data, I think the initial data taken to be zero, the other one is taken in this form, in this quadratic form. With these two parameters, we can play around with them. And the solution for these two options, of course, this option with W will eliminate the series solution and we'll end up with this solution in this form for the U and for the source term. We have chosen some numeric values for W naught and WT and W2 and the time just to get some numerical or solution and graphs, and that's what we got for the solution. This is for U and this is H. One can see that, of course, the effect of the chosen condition in the overall shape of the solution is clearly shown, and that the solution is has a maximum at zero, and this maximum actually is increasing as time is increases. Well, as we know that the source sum is independent of time as we have chosen it. And we have also studied the effect of the fractional order, how the solution will look like by changing alpha. Here we're presenting the solution for different alphas. We see that the maximum is at alpha equal one is very small compared to the other maximum with alpha less than one. Actually, as we reduce alpha, the maximum is increasing of the solution. The effect of changing alpha for the source term, it is there, but it is very slight, as you can see, just very small effect. Again, with the same, almost same effect of increasing the maximum. That's the end of the first part with the space degenerate PDE. Now we move to the inverse source problem for time degenerate PDE, and we have chosen this term in here, the value fractional derivative. And you see the term to the beta here. Again, we continue with that. And same rectangular domain. And now we have taken homogeneous boundary conditions with this initial conditions and over determining condition. Again, the initial condition is being taken for mathematical convenience to be able to solve the corresponding equation later on, as you will see. Again, these data are given, phi and psi, and of course they have to be zero at the boundary because of the imposed boundary condition in here. The same solution method that we are going to apply, looking for solution in a form of series expansion. Now, the eigenfunctions that we got from solving the homogeneous equation is correspond to a well-known Sturm-Liouville eigenvalue problem, which has the eigenfunctions in the form of sine functions, and the eigenvalues just n by
square.
Expansion in terms of sine series to find the coefficient u bar and h bar. But the fractional equation that we got in the time is very interesting. We got this fractional differential equation with this term here, t to the beta. Again, from the initial and the over determining conditions, we got these two conditions that can be help to solve this ordinary differential equation. These coefficients are known because we know the initial data and the over determining data. The solution of this problem is given by the following. Actually, it has this generalized Mittag-Leffler type function with three parameters. This is our UN, and if you plug it into the series, we get the series solution of U bar, which is a summation of that. And similarly, that would be our HK here, and that's the series solution. Now, the challenge here is the convergence of these such series would require an appropriate estimate for this type of Mittag-Leffler function, the generalized one. Here, as you can see, we have two different functions. One is something like alpha. If you start with the second one, this alpha, this is the same thing. So it's like alpha mm, while the other one is alpha, and this is m, and this was going to be like m minus 1 over alpha. So we need to find some estimate for these functions, which is a still ongoing problem with us. Of course, this is just to remind everybody with the definition of this generalized Mittag-Leffler function is given at summation of this product in here. So far, what we have done, we got this estimate for this function, and if this estimate works fine for arguments that's within between minus 1 and 1. And if our there is point we need to satisfy certain condition, this C is a point of minimum for gamma X. Of course, this would not work with our C solution because it requires higher values of the argument as we are taking summation. And we still work on this and also looking into the literature to see if there is anybody who works with this and got some estimate. So if anybody has anything in this, would be nice to share it and see. We have seen one archive paper, still we didn't actually check these results and still we didn't see it published to make sure that these results are correct. But we have this estimate for this type of generalized function with argument alpha m, m minus 1. This is going to be between this limit and this here. One is missing here. It's for 0 less than alpha less than or equal to 1, m positive, and z also any positive value. So this is one estimate that we have seen, and the other estimate that would work with us for one term of the series solution, because it has this nice, the same form as we have in there, it's alpha m, m minus 1 over alpha, we will have this estimate. But as I said, we didn't verify this. The paper still is archived paper. We haven't seen published anywhere. So the estimate of this generalized Mittag-Leffler function is still an open problem for us. And actually we are looking forward to meet Professor Karikova. If she's around, she might help in this because she's working on such type of problems. But nevertheless, if we go back to our solutions here, the convergence of this, yes, in general, it depends on the estimate of this Mittag-Leffler function, but the initial data, you see the phi bar here and the h bar, that also depend on psi bar and phi bar, would play a big role also in the convergence. If the choice of this data are reasonable, then we can eliminate again the series solution and we got a nice convergent solution. For this also we illustrate our solution with this choice of initial data, which was just assigned by X, and that will kill the series representation. We get only one term, and this is the other over determined condition. So for this special choice, just again, for sake of illustration, we got this solution, y bar. It, again, we have this Mittag-Leffler function generalized form, time sign, and this is for hx. Illustration of this, we have given it just for different time, for different alphas, and also for different betas. This is for different times, we see the solution. Again, the sign shape is there, affecting the form, the shape of the solution. But you can see also how these things are processing with time. As time increases, the maximum of solution is going to decrease until it gets here at t equal to 1, and this is the source function. This is the how the solution or the effect of alpha in the solution. Again, you see it is solution is decreasing with the decrease of alpha. For small alpha, we got this one here, alpha equal to 1, we are there. And that's for the source term, it's the other way around, it's increasing with the decrease of alpha. The almost the same effect we see with beta, with some slight changes only, but the same general effect. That's what we have for the time being, and we are looking forward actually for to see some kind of estimates for this generalized Mittag-Leffler function of generalized type of three parameters there. Thank you very much for this chance to be with you here today, and hope that we made this last talk very short so people can enjoy the rest of the day. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Your sound, Prof.
Sorry. Do you have any questions? So, can I ask you a question?
Yeah, sure, sure.
Yeah, in the first problem, are you looking for classical solution?
Yes, yes, Prof. We are looking for classical solution.
Yeah, but I didn't mention that you have studying convergence of derivatives of capital U.
Yeah, the derivative would be the same as h of x, actually, because that h has this term, so the maximum condition would required would be of this form.
Can you, yeah, maybe. Can you go back a little bit? Can you go back?
Yeah, we have it, we have this already done. If you want to, I'll share the
result. Okay. So you have studied this convergence of derivatives.
Yeah, I do have it. Yeah, it's there.
Okay.
I just didn't want to repeat things. Yeah.
Okay. How about in the second problem? So for the second problem, you haven't yet proved existence of solution.
The convergence is still not but, yet. But
yeah, but how about uniqueness? Do you have uniqueness for?
No, we haven't done it, but uniqueness here is much easier for the second problem because the eigenfunctions are of sign x. And this well known that it has completeness properties and can be done very straightforward.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, sign. Any other questions?
Yes. Sure.
So I have a brief question. So your convergence results, the convergence results as understood unclear because you rely on that estimate. There is another estimate known for this multi-parameter Mittag-Leffler function, the estimate in the paper of Yamamoto. But I guess the parameters that appear here are different from his parameters.
Yeah. The main challenge is the parameters is growing with time.
Sorry, Michael. What is done by Professor Yamamoto is another function, is multinomial Mittag-Leffler. This is kind of, we call generalized Mittag-Leffler function, usually sometimes they call the Kilbas-Saigo. And for this function only, that estimation is available up to now. I have contacted many specialists who somehow deal with that kind of functions. Professor Rogozin as well, and no information yet. Even in this later book monograph, Gorenflot, Ragozin, and Mainardi. So they have, they gave some certain properties for that function, but not the estimate, because as Dr. Nasser mentioned it, there is only one paper, which is in archive. We are waiting for the official publication. And honestly saying, it's very difficult to follow the proof of that estimates. That is why we are just waiting for official improvement. As Nasser mentioned it, we can only use one part. Here's it's a bit important about the parameters. There is an estimate only for certain parameters, and in case of other functions, we have some recurrence relation, and somehow you can get for another parameters as well. But it's a bit difficult for that function.
Okay. It's a very nice
okay.
problem.
Okay, thank you very much. Is there any questions? No, no questions. So how about, Michael, do we close today's section?